If we leave our western hemisphere and steer a course almost eastward across the Atlantic Ocean, we will pass through the Strait of Gibraltar and reach northwestern Africa. At the eastern end of the rugged Atlas Mountains, we find the Shawiya Berbers, a tribe of white people living almost completely cut off from the remainder of the world. They dwell in a forbidding desert region of canyons, steep cliffs, and high plateaus. From the south, the only entrance to the part we shall visit is through this narrow, deep canyon, an effective natural protection against enemies. We soon begin to see groups of crude, unlovely huts. Sometimes these are clustered at the base of mountains, but more often clinging halfway up the precipitous cliffs, or perched on the very top, an admirable natural protection. The only approach from the valley below is a steep, winding staircase cut in the face of a cliff. It comes out through a short tunnel at the top. This wild, isolated location, while keeping the Berbers' enemies away, has likewise kept out the benefits of advancing civilizations. They have not progressed. All about this village, we see goats being let out in the morning. For warmth during the cold nights, the people sleep on the second floor or on platforms above their goats. As each family's goats are turned out in the morning, they are driven through the streets to the community pasture on the plateau back of the village. Goats are highly valued by the Berbers for their milk, their hair, and their hides. So they are carefully tended as they graze on short grass and nibble the desert shrubs in their pasture. Goats endure the hot, dry climate much better than sheep. In the evening, the goats are brought back and are milked. Cheese is made from surplus milk in this crude goatskin churn. And here is another use for goatskin, to make water bags. These bags must be filled at wells far below in the valley and laboriously carried up to the village. Little girls soon learn that hard work is part of their daily life. These goatskin bags full of water weigh almost as much as the little girls who carry them. Water is highly valued for irrigation also. A crude water clock is used to apportion water for irrigating the small farm plots. The ancient water clock is a bronze bowl with holes in the bottom. It requires about 12 minutes to fill and sink. A small rock is used to record each filling and sinking. When the agreed-on number of rocks have accumulated, the course of the stream is changed without delay, so that it waters another man's land. The irrigated land is in the valley below the village. One of the main crops is the date harvest. When the dates are ripe, they are cut from the top of the stately palms and are carried far up the steep, winding cliff path to the village granary. Inside the granary, each family has a room in which it keeps its dates and grain. The bread dates here being brought in will be hung up and dried. Each man's product is carefully weighed in a crude beam balance. Then it is put away under guard in the community storehouse until needed. Rains are few, but when they come, torrential floods sweep down the valley. Here we see villagers removing the worthless sand which a flood has washed over their fertile valley garden. On every hand, we see the heavy work being done largely by women and girls of this backward Berber tribe. In a nearby plot, however, a man is at work plowing. Fences are made of boulders gathered from the fields. His plow is a forked tree branch with a bit of metal at the point where the tip digs into the shallow, rocky soil. And here is a Berber mill of the simpler sort, grinding flour from grain. Wealthier Berbers use cornstones. Grain poured in at the top comes out as flour along the sides. Each family bakes its own bread, making a dough from flour and water and adding a pinch of salt. This is the unleavened bread so often mentioned in the Bible, and neither this method of making it nor the utensils used have changed since the days of ancient Egypt. And now a real Berber delicacy, couscous, a dish made from cracked wheat, boiled in a pot over a bit of wood fire. Couscous is pleasing to the taste when salted and drenched in butter. The principal foods of the Berbers are sour milk, cheese, and bread, all rather flat tasting. In this hot country, food spoils very quickly, particularly fresh meats. We see this Berber woman grinding spice, which will improve the taste of such food. And in this rock, in a hole worn by centuries of use, juniper twigs are being pounded into a powder, thus making a kind of incense that burns with a pleasing odor. The Berbers must supply their own dishes, therefore pottery making is one of their chief industries. Selecting a location where there is good, pure clay, women and young girls dig it from the ground and sift out pebbles and lumps. They place a thistle in each basket to ward off evil spirits, which they believe might cause the pots to warp or crack. The clay is then carried to the village. Each woman is an expert in pottery making. She first moistens and kneads the clay into a mass of even consistency. It is then ready to shape. This Berber woman places the clay on a crude wheel, which turns and permits working on the pot from all sides. Beside the pottery maker, a young girl watches attentively, for someday this will be part of her work. Each Berber child is trained in exactly the same skills as his forefathers. Pottery making is one of the oldest arts, and the Berbers make their pottery in almost the same way as did their ancestors thousands of years ago. After the bits of clay have been roughly put in place, the pot begins to assume shape under skilled guiding fingers. It is constantly kept moist while being shaped. Now the handles are attached. After the pot has been allowed to dry in the sun, it is smoothed and polished by being rubbed with a large snail shell. Last of all, the bottom is trimmed and smooth, and the pot is ready to be decorated. This crude Berber design represents the tree of life. How remarkably is this like the pottery designs of thousands of years ago? After the pots have dried thoroughly, wood for the baking fire is brought to the village, mostly on the backs of women. Berber women, we have noted repeatedly, do most of the hard work. Wood is scarce and the supply must be carefully conserved. Therefore, the pots are placed in a community pile and one fire bakes them all. The women cover a broad, flat rock with layers of wood on which the pots are stacked. These, in turn, are covered with additional layers of wood and are weighted down with old pots. A little boy lights the fire. The Berbers have a superstition that if anyone else did it, bad luck would come and the pots would harden unevenly and crack. After about 2 hours, baking is completed. The pots are taken out and cleaned and covered with shellac while still quite hot. This gives them a shiny red luster and a glossy surface.